morning, church. It's September 20th. We are glad that you are worshiping with us wherever you are. We are grateful for your presence as a part of this beloved community. Even though we are not meeting in this space together, the Holy Spirit and technology connect us together as we work to encounter God in our time of worship together this morning. We're really glad that you are worshiping with us. If you didn't get a chance, make sure to go to the Watch Live button on our beachfaith.com website. You can find all kinds of stuff to help you create space and to participate in worship this morning, including sermon bingo for all ages and an at-home guide that you can print out to have the words for worship if that's helpful for you. There's lots of great things there, including an opportunity to sign up to be a reader in worship. We're always looking for faces that we miss to sign up and read scripture for us or offer a prayer. So if you're willing to do that, please go to that Watch Live button, click on the sign up button and make sure to sign up for that. We're always looking for pictures of you and or your family during this time of pandemic. So if you have one that or a couple that you can submit to ernie@beachfaith.com, we'd love to include those photos in upcoming worship services so we can see those faces and those people that we miss so much. We are continuing to be faithful as we listen to the health experts and scientists and the church leaders in terms of what is best for us as we move forward. While we miss being physically together in this place, we know that God is working with us in this time of new normal, that God is making a way. As we continue our series on making a way and God leading the way, it will be good for us to remember that. God is with us. God provides all that we need. God is leading the way. Let us worship God with praise and thanksgiving.
Good morning, friends. It's good to be with you this morning. Please hear these words as we are called to gather together for worship. Lord God, you are the one who brought us out of Egypt. You are the one we have followed into the desert and the one we wait for now in this holy place. Lord, we are an impatient people. If we sit here for long, we too might start collecting jewelry and casting objects to take our attention and devotion. Smartphones, iPads, video games, sports teams, Facebook. Lord, we are an impatient people. We've been away from one another for far too long. We've been away from our beloved sacred space. How do we seek an experience with you that is awe-inspiring? No wonder we turn to the first shiny thing to get our attention. Lord, do not give up on us. Turn your anger away from us and grace us with your Holy Spirit. Help us to encounter you in this time of worship that we might know of your presence and grace.
Come now. Glad hour, the who almighty are. We praise you, O God, with words of thanksgiving in our mouths and in our hearts, words which can never really do justice to the depth of your care for us. We rejoice in your blessings, yet we so often fail to live up to them. Like your people of old, we often desire to fashion you in our image or in ways that we can control. Knowing these failings of ours as you do, you still invite us to share your life of grace and abundant love by being united with Jesus Christ through the power of your Spirit. We do not deserve such gifts. We can only receive them and respond because Jesus intercedes for us in our weakness. May this time of worship and our daily living proclaim our thanksgiving for these undeserved and lavish gifts of grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hello, friends. It's good to be with you again on this Sunday morning. I brought something to share with you. Check out this awesome stuff, Banimal. It's pretty cool, huh? I know it looks old, but it is so special to me. It was my favorite bear when I was a little boy. I remember taking it everywhere with me. It would protect me at night, in the dark, when I was afraid. And in fact, it was the very best thing in the whole world, I thought. There was nothing better. And you know what? I thought it had special powers. I bet it does. Oh, wait, hold on. What's this? Well, looks like some of the stuffing's coming out. Well, and his fur is kind of matted and stiff. I guess it really is just a toy. There's nothing that special about it, except for, you know, I loved it when I was little. And it certainly doesn't have any special powers. Wouldn't it be silly to think that someone would, that something someone made would have special powers? But that's exactly what happens in our Bible story today. So last week, we heard the story of God giving the people the Ten Commandments. Moses went up on the mountain to talk to God. He was on Mount Sinai for a very long time, while the Israelites waited down below. After a while, they began to think that Moses was not coming back, and they started to get anxious and worried. They wondered, who will lead us out of the desert if Moses doesn't return? How will we get to the Promised Land? So they came up with a plan. They became so impatient and decided they needed to make their own God to worship. They gathered all their gold, melted it, and made it into a golden calf. They worshiped that calf like it was the most powerful thing in the world. They had stopped believing that God was real and made a fake God to worship. It was a very silly decision that made God and Moses very angry. The people were breaking the very first commandment. God is the one true God, and you shall have no other gods or worship any other gods. God had saved them from slavery in Egypt and was even guiding them to a new home, but they still built this fake God. How silly is that? So, God knew what they were doing down there, and he was not happy, and he really wanted to punish them. I mean, really punish them. But Moses knew that he had an important job to do. He had been chosen to lead the Israelites, and he knew that he had to be their voice to protect them. So instead of destroying all the people, God listened to Moses and decided to save them. Their people's sin was really great, but God's grace is greater. God continued to love them. So, Beach Faith kids, what can we learn from this? When you treat a regular thing like it's God, that's a big mistake. You might think there's no way you would treat a golden cow like God, but sometimes we do treat little things like God, like our toys or something at school or our friends or even our family. We let things get in the way and take focus off what really matters, and that's God. So do your best to not let little things get in the way, and no matter what, make sure God is the most important thing in your life. Because when you know God is always with you, you know that you are loved and you can share that love with others, right? I think that's a pretty good message, that you're loved and you can share it. What's better than that? So let's pray together. God, Thank you so much for leading us out of the desert and not giving up on us. We know that with you, all things are possible. Thank you for your great grace in our lives and always showing us that we are loved no matter what. Amen. Amen. Have an awesome week with your teachers and your friends and your family. And remember that I love you and I miss you, and I hope to see you soon.
Reading from the book of Exodus, chapter 32, verses 1 through 14. When the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said, "Come, make us gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses who brought us out of Egypt, we don't know what has happened to him." Aaron answered them, "Take off your gold earrings that your wives, your sons, and your daughters are wearing, and bring them to me." So all the people took off their earrings and brought them to Aaron. He took what they handed him and made it into an idol cast in the shape of a calf, fashioning it with a tool. Then they said, "These are your gods, Israel, who brought you out of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar in front of the calf and announced, "Tomorrow there will be a festival to the Lord." So the next day, the people rose early and sacrificed burnt offerings and presented fellowship offerings. Afterward, they sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Go down, because your people, whom you brought out of Egypt, have become corrupt. They have been quick to turn away from what I commanded them and have made themselves an idol cast in the shape of a calf. They have bowed down to it and sacrificed to it and have said, 'These are your gods, Israel, who brought you out of Egypt.' I have seen these people," the Lord said to Moses, "and they are stiff-necked people. Now leave me alone so that my anger may burn against them and that I may destroy them. Then I will make you into a great nation." But Moses sought the favor of the Lord his God. "Lord," he said, "why should your anger burn against your people, whom you brought out of Egypt with great power and a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, 'It was with evil intent that he brought them out, to kill them in the mountains and to wipe them off the face of the earth'? Turn from your fierce anger, relent, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember your servants Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, to whom you swore by your own self, 'I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and I will give your descendants all this land I promised them, and it will be their inheritance forever.'" Then the Lord relented and did not bring on his people the disaster he had threatened. This is the word of the Lord.
Faithful God of an unfaithful people, The people of Israel doubted your power and turned to other gods to fulfill their needs. We too turn to other gods, seeking acceptance, power, and independence. Show us how to live humbly in you and walk in your ways. In the name of the one who offered true power to all humanity, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Last week, God gave Moses the Ten Commandments. The first few were about how the people relate to God. The last few commandments were about how they are to relate to each other. God gave these ten to Moses to make sure that everyone was on the same page as to what was expected of God's people. God traveled around with the Israelites in the desert, you might recall, as a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. In other words, God was present and also enigmatic. God was with them, but also not tangible. When I was in college, I often drove up PCH to Cal State Long Beach from my home. I loved driving the coast because, well, I could. I often found myself in a fog bank either early in the morning or late at night. Now, anyone who's driven in fog knows that while in the fog cloud, you can see the cloud around you and not much else. At times, it was an act of faith to move forward in fog, uncertain of what's ahead. And fire? To touch fire causes our skin to burn. It's not something that one would do intentionally. The fact that God showed up in these forms may not have been comforting or helpful to a people who looked for some sort of tangible way to know God. Moses, as God's spokesperson, was the closest thing they had. When both of them disappeared together to go iron some specifics out, they left the Israelites feeling abandoned and afraid. Which is exactly what happened. In the chapters following last week's reading, God asked Moses to spend some time up the mountain in conversation. Chapter 24 tells us that Moses and God spoke for 40 days and 40 nights. It was not clear how long Moses would be up there with God when he left. This left the Israelites at the foot of the mountain without God or Moses' close presence. You can imagine that this is not what the Israelites wanted to experience. They were in the wilderness, uncertain of the future, not sure where the promised land was and whether they would ever get there. They remembered the good parts of their captivity, routine, meals, even the opportunity to buy jewelry and clothing and other items they fancied. Without leadership, without clear purpose, without something that they could touch and feel and know that would help them envision a future with hope, by the time we get to the reading that Nina just read for us, there's a whole lot of mess about to happen. The Israelites felt abandoned, impatient, afraid. Their frustrations grew as time went on and Moses did not return. In their frustration, the group starts talking to each other, venting their frustrations and concerns. I used to joke that this is what used to happen over brunch on Sundays after worship. Folks would go out with church friends, a concern would be raised, and the next thing you know, someone is calling the church office during the week saying, much like the Israelites did, a lot of us were talking and dot, dot, dot. In the event of a leader's absence, especially in trying times, we can understand how easy it was to grasp for straws, to look for something that will anchor them in the community. The God who led the Israelites out of Egypt and Moses, the one God appointed to lead the people to freedom, were absent. They ghosted the people. The people needed grounding and a sense of hope. Aaron, who will eventually become the first high priest, felt the mob pushing in on him. Aaron wanted to please the people and provide them some sort of pacifier that might help them feel safe and secure and hopeful. Even though he knew what God expected, no false idols, please, the Israelites lived in the ancient Near East among a myriad of cultures that made images of their gods to worship. That's what you did in that time frame. So Aaron, uncertain of when that divine conversation happening up the mountain would end, told the people to bring their gold together in one place. He then helped them fashion it into some sort of something and left the people to decide on what it was for themselves. No harm, no foul. Somehow, my guess is that someone in the Israelite community, while in slavery, worked with Pharaoh's goldsmiths to create idols of Egyptian gods. And those folks helped melt all that precious metal down and fashioned it like a calf. Scholars discovered that calves were used to represent the Egyptian god Apsis and the Canaanite god Baal. Two bits of trivia for your next Zoom trivia party. Here, Aaron crafted it and gave it to the people to be a stand-in for God, or perhaps even for the absent Moses. The golden calf becomes the centerpiece on which the Israelites could put their attention and devotion. And that's what they did. The scripture tells us that the Israelites worshiped this newly formed statue and then threw a raging party, what might be thought of as an ancient rave, filled with food and wine and dance, and in the Hebrew, play. The kind of play this refers to in Hebrew is one that comes with a wink, because it was an adult kind of play, if you know what I mean. Meanwhile, the story tells us that God stops mid-sentence because God knows what the people did. Like a parent of a middle schooler, God's angry at the choices the Israelites made and ready to help them learn their lesson. The lesson would be harsh and would eliminate completely the people that God called God's own. Moses prayed and pleaded with God that God would spare God's people and that God would remember God's promises to his ancestors. You can sense that Moses was deeply concerned about God's anger and sought mercy and grace for the people. Our story ends with God relenting. God changed God's mind thanks to Moses' prayerful plea. While we could spend time on this last part where Moses' prayer changes God's mind and stops mass annihilation, and the comfort that brings knowing that God hears our prayers and considers our petitions, I want to talk a little bit more about Aaron. Aaron's been mostly in the background of our story, doing Moses' bidding when needed. Clearly not the head leader. Aaron is someone I think many of us can relate to. We've been in his shoes a time or two when pressed by a tough situation. Aaron is not meant to take the full blame in this story. He's meant to help us ask important theological, moral, and ethical questions. Have you ever had to compromise your theology in order to not upset the people? Or to put it another way, have you pleased others because it was the easier, more popular thing to do over standing your ground in what you believe? Aaron was a practical leader. He was willing to compromise what he believed in order to appease people. After all, Moses and God were absent. He had a mob on his hands. Who blames him for what he did? The people wanted something tangible. What harm could there be in that? At least it kept them from griping at him. I wonder if Aaron felt okay about the decision he made after the party started and things got a little out of hand. I wonder if Aaron got a little nervous then. The problem with subtle choices like what Aaron made is that the quick fix of making the idol allowed the people that feeling of instant gratification that then set up a not so good precedent. Aaron let the people get their way. The boundaries God set up in the Ten Commandments were broken by the simple act of giving the people what they wanted. The result was that the people went bonkers. Without God's clear boundaries of what was acceptable and what was not, the people were out of control and on the path to death and destruction. Sure, it felt good for the moment, but that instant feeling was fleeting, especially if God had anything to do with it. You know, sometimes we make those little choices like Aaron did, don't we? Rather than getting into a conflict, we choose an easier, quicker, less confrontational way out. Someone gets the toy or the cookie or whatever it is they want. Like Veruca Salt and Willy Wonka's Chocolate Factory, once we've gotten the first thing we ask for, we won't stop. Nothing satisfies us for long. We need the next hit, the next thing. Sure, it kept the Israelites from harping or complaining at Aaron. Aaron didn't seem to know how to hold the line and tell the people to continue to trust and to be patient. God and Moses were, after all, up to good things that would help them to thrive and journey well together. The people needed to be patient and to trust them. Aaron wasn't strong in the face of the intense pressure of the mob. He gave in. At times, we all do. I think we all want to be liked. We don't want to upset people, and we don't want people upset with us. These are some basic things that Aaron had going for him that we can easily relate to. Aaron learned that choosing comfort over courage led to consequences that he and the people didn't want. I know I've learned in my life this lesson over and over again. I've learned the hard way that when you spend your whole life pleasing others, you lose your sense of true north, your moral compass, what grounds you. It becomes about giving others what they want, even if what they want is just a quick fix, something instantly gratifying, something that then compromises what you believe in, something that diverts anger or impatience and or frustration over you setting a clear boundary. Sometimes I've not had the courage to stand up for what I believe in or chose comfort because it was the easy way to keep friends. What this did is it disengaged me from what I believe, what I stand for, what God called me to stand for. The older I get, the less important it is for me to be liked and instead to be able to stand up for the harder and important things I believe in because it's the right thing to do. Sometimes it might mean I am all alone in the wilderness, but that's okay because I trust that God is with me, helping me to make a way. Can you relate? I know that middle school is a time where we often fail at just this. Middle schoolers want so much to be liked and popular that middle schoolers will do whatever it takes to get that need filled, even if it means harming themselves. What we learn from this story is that Aaron is more subtle. He's like a parent. He figures out how to pacify the people for what he hopes is long enough that Moses can come back and toe the line with them. He thinks that he can give them what they want, still be liked, and that Moses will clean the mess up for him. Of course, that's not what happens. This story is one that calls us into accountability in a good way. It invites us to check in with ourselves, to do a moral and ethical and even theological inventory. Are you holding your ground, standing in what you believe in? Or are you persuaded by the crowd or the shiny thing that gains your attention momentarily? Do you need to be liked more than you need to stand in what God calls you to believe? On the flip side, what's the golden calf in your life? The thing that you need to pacify you, the thing that gets your attention and keeps it away from what God desires of you. Are you like Aaron, willing to wilt under pressure and give in so that you can remain liked by others? Or are you willing to stand like Moses, ready to stand up for what you believe in and also prayerfully plead with God for mercy and grace? You know, try as they might, another major crisis in the relationship between God and the people, does not undermine what's been established. You can bet the Israelites will learn from their mistakes and live with the consequences of choosing the fast, easy, pleasing choice over the tougher, solid choice God gave them. Aaron's reputation takes a bit of a hit as a result of caving under pressure. And yet, God refused to give up on these sometimes stiff-necked former slaves. And God refuses to give up on us too. God desires for us to think about our intentions, about God's intentions, and about how we are called at times to hold the line, especially in the face of a frustrated mob. To remember that we are ultimately loved by God, and that love is more powerful than being liked in a moment. Had Aaron said no to the people instead of appeasing them, a lot of heartache and consequence and wilderness might not have been a part of the Israelites' future story. Perhaps the same might be true for us too. It is important for us to hold the line during this pandemic and to not give into easy appeasements. For everyone's benefit, it is easier to stay on the side of life and safety rather than rush to do something that might endanger others and be called a super spreader event. I know this is not what you want, but it is what will honor God and one another until we are out of this pandemic wilderness and able to be together once again in person. So let us trust that God is with us, that God provides what we need, and God will lead the way to hope and wholeness and well-being. God will help us find one another in person again. Let's trust this hope in God's work among us together. As we prepare to pass the plate and receive our tithes and offerings for this morning, our gifts to the faithful ministry we're called to do in Jesus Christ, there are three ways that you can give those tithes and offerings. The first is to mail your gifts into the church or drop them in our church mail slot. If you need some addressed envelopes, just let Ernie know. He'd be happy to send those to you to help with that process. Or you can go to our website, beachfaith.com, click on the donate button, and find two secure ways to give online. Our third and more new option is to text BeachFaith and the dollar amount to the number on the screen below. That will allow you to receive a link to help set up online giving either once or recurring there, and it magically goes into your giving statement. All three ways help us to receive those gifts so we can be good stewards of your offerings to God in this time. Thanks be to God for your faithful giving and generosity and for this beloved community that continues to do ministry in the name of Jesus Christ in this place and throughout the world.
Spirit of Wind and Fire, bless these gifts of our labors and transform them into your work in this world. Make them be a blessing for all who search for your bounty. May your spirit continue to call us forth to live a life of giving. Amen.
He was there.
Church, let us pray together. God, we come into your presence with praise and thanksgiving for your faithful love. Your love never fails, not even when we turn away from you. When we ignore your invitation or desert you for gods of our own making. Even then, you do not abandon us, but reach out again and again, inviting us back into relationship once more. As you welcome us, so you welcome our prayers. We bring them to you with confidence, knowing that you will hear and answer. We pray for the world you created and the people who share it with us, for our world drowning in pandemic, for countries caught up in war or violent conflict, for regions of the world recovering from hurricanes and flooding, for the starving people nearby and across the world, for these and all the other areas in our world where there is need and despair. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our country and for its people, for our government leaders, federal and local, for our judicial system, police forces, and military, for our cities, towns, and rural communities, for immigrants and indigenous people, for employers and employees, for young and old, for all who are a part of this great country. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our local South Bay community, for the people of Redondo Beach and surrounding cities, for those who are unemployed, for those in prison, for those who are hungry, for those who are alone and afraid, for all our neighbors, both known and unknown to us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for this congregation, our brothers and sisters in Christ, who we miss seeing face to face very much, for those who are ill, for those who are anxious about the future, for those struggling with their faith, for those who minister among us, for all your people who call this space their spiritual home. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray now for those on our hearts and minds in a time of silent prayer. Pour out your spirit on us. Fix our hearts and minds on what is true and honorable and right. Give us the joy and peace that comes from knowing and doing your will. Help us be faithful to the call we have received in Christ Jesus, our Lord, extending your loving invitation to the world around us. We pray now the prayer Jesus taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen.
What a great morning of worship we've had together, beloved community. As we go about our day and our week, let us hear this blessing. May the power and blessing of Almighty God go with you as you leave now to minister to a weary world, remembering to make good and holy choices that will channel love, compassion, and the presence of God to those around us. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and those you love. Amen.